for doing an all host sync while we're on the air. I love when they do that. At least we don't have to go then.
I feel like they're doing them. Hey, we're live, man. Going live. 45 seconds. I'm just reading this order quick from Mershon.
Right, I'm going to turn you boys off.
Is that the gag order?
Yeah.
Off.
The Devil's Advocates radio show is broadcast under a time brokerage agreement between Devil Radio and Civic Media, Inc. Some portions of this program may be pre-recorded. Warning! You're about to listen to the greatest radio show ever, and due to contractual obligations and to shield our airwaves and corporate licensees from any semblance of liability, responsibility, and gullibility, we must tell you the views represented on this show are not necessarily those of this station or its management. This radio show contains differing points of view on current political topics, and due to the nature of its contents, it should be heard by everyone. Thank you for listening. Now live from the Civic Media Studios in Madison, Wisconsin, where the political party is just beginning, welcome to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. Friends proving it's never personal, only politics.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
And now, here's your hosts, Dom and Crute.
Welcome to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show, the Tuesday edition. Dom, I suspect it's tacos for dinner.
No, man, it's Drag Queen Bingo tonight at the Lakefront Brewery, so I'm sure there'll be some fried cheese and beer involved. But, you know, we'll see what happens. Not tonight. No, not tonight. Happy Tuesday to you, Crudy Rich, working hard on the board. Thank you, sir. Of course, our audience. Happy Taco Tuesday, everyone.
Absolutely. And, Dom, a little bad news right from the top. Donald Trump's coming back to Wisconsin.
Oh, no. Next he's darkening our skies. Next Tuesday, isn't there an election next Tuesday?
There is an election next Tuesday, and Donald Trump is on the ballot, and he's going to darken the doorstep of Green Bay, where we've got WGBW 97.9 FM. We're playing out there right now, Dom, and Trump's coming to town, probably to stiff the municipality again for his police
bills. C-O-D. That's what that means. C-O-D.
Good luck getting paid. Dom, we just learned within the last 20 minutes, and I understand there may have been an update of this story, so I'd hate to leave any of this out for the sake of our fair audience. Here is what's being reported. Donald Trump to hold first Wisconsin campaign rally of 2024 in Green Bay. My understanding, Dom, he has not been in the state of Wisconsin to campaign rally since Waukesha County, the Tim Michaels, the Adam Steed against Robin Foss.
Yeah, that's right. And that did not work out too great for Tim Michaels. In fact, lots of Republicans have been losing since the mega takeover of the formerly known as the GOP.
Hey, stop pointing out the obvious. Dateline Madison, Republican former president Donald Trump will hold his first Wisconsin rally of the 2024 presidential race next Tuesday, April 2nd. Trump will visit Green Bay on the day of the state's presidential primary election, his campaign announced Tuesday. I got 5-1 on the Rush Center, Dom.
Oh, so they scraped up enough money out of the couch cushions to be able to come out and actually do this one, unlike the one reportedly they canceled in Arizona for lack of funding.
Dominic, the announcement follows a string of visits from Biden and his surrogates in recent weeks, including VP Kamala Harris. I saw her. First Lady Jill Biden, she was in Waukesha. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen, the Biden campaign officially launched canvassing efforts throughout the state earlier this month following a visit to Milwaukee by the president. That's the good one, Joe Biden. In a statement following Biden's most recent Wisconsin visit, Trump blasted the president for arguing to voters his policies would improve economics for Milwaukee families and said Biden was touting his failed Bidenomics policies in the Badger State.
Is that what he's doing? What were your accomplishments? Tax cut.
Of course, man.
Dom, Trump was last in Wisconsin in the 2022 campaigning for construction mogul Tim Michaels. You know, when Michaels informed all of the attending Wisconsinites were lazy.
You're lazy, Dom, people. You're so lazy.
That was the head of the Republican gubernatorial primary when he effectively was sticking it to Rebecca Clayfish. The former president hosted a rally in Waukesha County Fairgrounds to stump for Michaels, but also used the opportunity to continue to promote his false claims about the 2020 election loss in Wisconsin. The big lie, it was rigged. Pushing candidates to call for the abolition of the State Elections Commission over allegations of voter fraud that have not been proven in the years since Trump first made them. Biden defeated Trump in Wisconsin by about 20,000 votes in 2020. A victory Trump sought to overturn in part prompted the January 6, 2021 attack by his supporters on the U.S. Capitol.
Ah, an attack. It sounds so violent, you know, when you put it like that. According to Ron Johnson, they were just inside the velvet ropes until they weren't.
Dominic, though his mission at the Waukesha rally in 2022 was to promote Michaels and criticize his GOP opponent, former Lieutenant Governor Rebecca Clayfish, Trump leveled his strongest condemnation at Assembly Speaker Robin Voss, who repeatedly refused the former president's calls to overturn the election results. Just because it's not possible doesn't mean you shouldn't have done it, Robin Voss.
I mean, if you're a true loyalist, if you're a true MAGA, you do everything you can.
Dominic, despite their previous disputes and calling Trump's nomination a suicide mission for Republicans, Voss, the state's longest serving assembly speaker and the most effective Republican in the GOP-controlled state legislature, recently endorsed the former president.
They've merged their agendas, Michael.
It's going to be, do you think the policies that Joe Biden has put in place over the course of the last 4 years are better for the country, or were the times better under Donald Trump? Empirically, I think it's pretty clear they're better under Biden, but I read on. When we actually had low inflation, low taxes, more control at the border, Voss told reporters. Now, Dom, Wisconsin is just one of a handful of states that will decide the next presidential contest. And as of now, Biden and Trump are each tied at 49% amongst registered voters in the battleground state, where races are often decided by razor-thin margins, something that very rarely touches your face, Dom, a razor. Just 2% of those surveyed in the most recent Marquette University Law School polls released February 7th said they hadn't decided on whom to support in the November election. 2% of undecideds, Dom. The poll highlighted a potential enthusiasm gap in the Biden-Trump matchup. Among voters who are very enthusiastic about the election, Trump led Biden by 19 points. But in all other categories, Biden led Trump by an average of 18 points. For whatever that's worth, Dom.
Whatever
that's worth. The enthusiasm to vote for Trump is very high amongst the MAGA Republican.
Yeah, voters. Man, those cult members, they're very excited to drink the Kool-Aid and offer you some. Hell, come on back. Listen, COD, Green Bay. Now, I know the guy's coming and you got to provide security, whatever, but, you know, this is a campaign. I'd get that money up for rent. You know what I'm saying? Do they still owe Green Bay money, Crudy?
I did a little Googling research, and it would seem to be indicated by the Fox 11 News that he did still owe the community of Green Bay money, at least as late as January 18th of 2021, Dom. The January 6th had already occurred. He wasn't going to pay any bills after that for jerseys.
Right, dude.
Here is Dateline Green Bay, WLUK, Foxy News 11, Dom. When you get a bill in the mail, you typically go online or cut a check to pay. That's not the case for all presidential candidates. We've reached out several times, Green Bay Chief of Staff Celestine Jeffrey said, based on spreadsheets from City Hall, President Donald Trump's campaign owes Green Bay more than $9,000 for a campaign stop in 2016. Now, the Trump campaign isn't alone. Hillary Clinton's campaign still owes Green Bay more than $11,000.
What? Come on. What is there? These national politicians coming to our state and stiffen us? That's terrible.
While we really enjoy having that personal contact, we very much like them to pay their debts. And it's not just Green Bay that candidates owe multiple municipalities, according to the invoices. The bills are primarily for police services. Between 2016 and 2020 campaign stops, the Trump campaign owes more than $100,000, Dom. And the majority is owed to Eau Claire and Oshkosh. Now, Eau Claire is owed $47,400 by the Trump campaign, and Oshkosh is owed about $24,000 by the Trump campaign. Now, the Clinton campaign owes more than $18,000 between Green Bay and Eau Claire for primary election visits. When did she come? Clinton never came to Wisconsin for the general election campaigning. So
it must have been the primary, but wow. I mean, talk about, you know, personal responsibility and all that.
Well, Trump still owes. And I don't think you're going to get any money out of the Hillary Clinton campaign. Probably, although better funded, perhaps, than the Trump campaign at this late hour.
Even now, even today.
Hillary probably could raise the money more readily than Trump could at this late hour, I suspect.
I've been pondering, Crudy, once this news came out and then kind of reflecting yesterday on the conversation of the former RNC chief, Romney, going to NBC and NBC, MSNBC, a lot of the journalists over there freaking out, perhaps rightfully so, and we'll see what happens on that. But if the criticism is, she's a liar and da-da-da-da-da, I mean, all she's doing that in support and subservience to Donald Trump. So, I mean, how do you cover this guy, I guess, is ultimately my question. You know, I know we plan on maybe having a little get-together next Tuesday. I don't want to go see the orange fascist anymore. I've had plenty of that. But how should it be covered? If people are going to, like, drop all over Romney for that hire, and I get it's journalism and whatnot, how do you properly cover a guy like Donald Trump, the rapist like Donald Trump, the fraud that is Donald Trump? I mean, this guy's coming in next week, Tuesday, man. And like 13 days after that, he's going to show up in, you know, Manhattan. Alvin Bragg's criminal trial is apparently supposed to start April 15th. What's a proper way to cover the criminal in chief?
Well, apparently every single day, Dom. That's what we end up doing, is it not? When the former president comes to town, Dom, that is newsworthy activity. But should they fail to credential the greatest radio show host ever, that would be very newsworthy non-activity.
Can they give him a collection notice when he rolls into town? Can somebody pay the bills? I mean, you have a bunch of collection agents lined up in Green Bay waiting to get their piece of Donald Trump.
They'd have to get in line, wouldn't they?
That's what I'm saying.
Come back with us. Maybe you could just post a modest bond. Some percentage of the amount owed.
Like a third.
Less than a third. It's good.
Sure it is.
Take to the local courts. See if you can get it knocked down like a parking ticket. Or Devil's Advocates. Trump's coming to Green Bay. Dom ain't going. Apparently. 844-967-2789. Join us.
the Devil's Advocates, because freedom.
Yeah, thank you for listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show. Phone lines open. Love it when you play along. 844-967-2789.
Dominic, more disappointing news for Green Bay, question mark? Robert Kennedy Jr. has made his vice presidential selection, and it's not former Packer quarterback Aaron Rodgers.
Oh, man. I mean, he got pulled through the ringer for all those asinine statements. They could have stayed hidden until he poked his head up and people are like, oh, what'd this guy say? Oh my God, Aaron Rodgers, you're a nut job. Oh, you're not running? You're not going to get it? Okay, well, good luck next year in New Jersey, dude. I mean, why even bother?
Who is Nicole Shanahan?
Who?
Is that Mike Shanahan's wife?
Aaron, the coach?
Right. Meet the wealthy entrepreneur RFK Jr. selected as his VP running mate. Kennedy announced his selection of Shanahan in her hometown, Oakland, California, the city
Oak by
the
town, bay. Baby.
Independent presidential candidate Robert F. Kennedy Jr. announced Tuesday that attorney and tech entrepreneur Nicole Shanahan will be his VP running mate heading into the November general. The native of Oakland, a 38-year-old, Shanahan is a philanthropist with a long history of donating to Democratic and left-leaning causes, including supporting President Biden in his 2020 election bid before switching to Kennedy when he launched his own run for the Democratic nomination last year. Now, Kennedy announced Shanahan by praising her insight into how big tech uses AI to manipulate the public, her athletic ability. Apparently, he admires athletes, Dom. Because other than, I mean, who were his other named potential candidates? Well, I heard three, actually. I heard Aaron Rodgers, Jesse the Body Ventura, and I did hear Killer Mike bantered about less athletic than the other.
I mean, you know, really?
Dom, no one ever said I admire his athletic ability.
Wasn't he? Didn't he have he took some pictures with his shirt off and wearing jeans on the beach doing some push-ups or some bench press or something a while back. He's pretty buff for an old guy, but yeah. And so what, man, we got to get beyond these physical things. Oh, he's in great shape. He'd make a great president. Oh, he was a reality TV star. He'll make a great president. Oh, she's a philanthropist at 38 years old, gives lots of money to causes. She'll be a great vice president. You know what? Based on what? I mean, literally
lots of money to Robert F. Kennedy Jr. Yeah. Which is why, well, apparently she
supported Biden before, according to that article.
Yeah, but
yeah, so what? He doesn't make
Biden's got other supporters. He needs this one, right? This could be his only sugar mama. So anyways, a little
my understanding is she funded that commercial he ran during the Super Bowl.
Shanahan initially dropped her support for Kennedy after he decided to run as an independent, but later got behind him again by giving $4 million to the Super PAC that boosted his candidacy with a John F. Kennedy themed campaign ad that ran during the Super Bowl in February. That's a lot of jing, Dom. It's a very nice gift.
It's a lot of philanthropy.
Shanahan also previously donated to Democratic presidential candidates Marianne Williamson and Pete Buttigieg before the 2020 presidential and threw more than $150,000 behind progressive Los Angeles District Attorney George Gascon's 2020 election bid. She is the founder and president of Baya Echo Foundation, a private firm that describes its mission as focused on none of your business. on new frontiers in reproductive longevity and equality, criminal justice reform, and healthy and livable planet. That's quite a catch-all, Dom. She's got a plethora of missions. Shanahan was previously married to Google co-founder Sergey Brin, a marriage that ended following reports she had an affair with Tesla CEO Elon Musk, which both of them deny. She has one daughter from her marriage with Brin, so she likes the rich dudes. I suspect she has a few of her own shekels lying around, Dom. That might be her greatest qualification for the RFK Jr.
And you know, someone's
got to fund this little trip.
I guess. A little bit on this also from the Washington Post. Kennedy said, quote, "I need someone with a spiritual dimension and compassion and idealism, and above all, a deep love for the United States of America. I found all those qualities in a woman who grew up right here in Oakland, daughter of immigrants who overcame every daunting obstacle and went on to achieve the highest ideals of the American dream."
The highest.
She's rich. And she's an attorney, so apparently she's pretty smart, but okay. Why should she be the vice president? Why, if Kennedy drops dead, should Nicole Shanahan become president?
Because she is a fierce warrior mom, as she's been described here. The Democratic Party is supposed to be the party of compassion. It's supposed to be the party of free speech, and most importantly, the party of the middle class and the American dream. You're far from middle class at this point, Shanahan. While I know many Democrats still abide by those values, I do believe they've lost their way in their leadership, she argued. And she urged disillusioned Democrats and Republicans to support Kennedy's independent White House bid. Oh, I'd say there's some disillusionment going on there.
Yeah. A little projection, perhaps.
According to the Foxy News Digital, which is my source, Dom, the Trump-aligned super PAC, Make America Great Again, took aim at both Kennedy and Shanahan. You know, now she's part of the ticket, right? She gets
that's right. Gotta add her on. Yep.
Here's what they said, according to spokesman Alex Pfeiffer of MAGA Incorporated, MAGA Inc.
Oh my God.
Robert F. Kennedy Jr. is a far left radical that supports reparations, backs the Green New Deal, and wants to ban fracking. It's no surprise that he would pick a Biden donor leftist as his running mate. Anyways, he's got a running mate. It's not Aaron Rodgers.
How does that make you feel, man? I know. I mean, were you hoping it would be Aaron? Would that make it a little more interesting for you? What was your how are you feeling about it now, Crudy? Talk to me. I'm listening.
A little disillusioned. A little disillusioned. 844-967-2789. Dick from Madison. Welcome, man. Trump's coming to town. RFK Jr.'s got a VP. And you, sir, are on the greatest radio show ever. Welcome to it.
Hey, Dick. Hello, Dick.
I guess the line.
Hey, guys.
Oh, come on, man.
Robert F. Kennedy, I mean, here's a guy I watched a little bit of it until they had it on Spectrum. I was looking for the weather when I got home from work, and they were actually had it on Spectrum's news channel, his selection of this gal. And it was just the most he was evoking all his stuff about his dad, and I'm thinking, well, dude, your dad also had you vaccinated when you were a kid, you dumb. You know what? But to Trump, if the Democrats don't get on this, I mean, ASAP. And just the minute this guy gets here, pay your bills. Pay your bills. And Freddie the Freeloader coming to the state. I mean, come on. This is just ridiculous. Was he over 100 grand to the state of Wisconsin? And these frugal Germans like my parents were, they'd be aghast by this. There's a lot of cheapskates in Wisconsin. You guys know that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I do that, a show with one.
Come on, man. I'm a lot of things, but cheap ain't one of them.
Thanks for the call, Dick. You're absolutely right. I mean, obviously, there's so many ways to go after this guy. And not paying his bills to the state of Wisconsin is certainly low on the list, but it's another one. Come back, join us, 844-96-PARTY.
the Devil's Advocates. Rock and roll political commentary in a top 40 world.
Welcome back to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show, the Tuesday edition. Happy spring break to a lot of the kids this week. My kid's been playing a lot of poker, you know, being very industrious, staying up late, sleeping all day.
Yeah, a lot of folks on the road, man. Be safe out there. Enjoy the time.
Donald Trump going on the road to the great state of Wisconsin, although he'll probably fly his Trump Force One into Austin Strobel, I suspect. Now, is that plane seizable? I guess he's dodged that bullet.
Well, he's got 9 days to come up with $175 million. I've seen no reporting that has happened yet, so
you know,
we'll
I was
see.
A little disillusioned yesterday, a little just a little bothered. You know, I wanted disastrously bad news for Donald Trump.
You're always bothered, though, Curtis. It's like a normal state of mind for you.
Well, you know, it's how I stay positive, Don.
Yeah.
But, you know, I was particularly bothered, especially by your glee, your mood, because you seem way too freaking happy in light of the headlines of the day that Donald Trump had been given a lifeline. He saw his bond reduced to $175 million. And I got to tell you, last night watching, I watched some Foxy News because apparently I'm a sadomasochist, glutton for punishment, if you will. I turned on the Jesse Waters show and watched just a little of the Hannity. Because my wife was out of town last night, so I'm allowed to watch Fox when she's not around. She will get up and leave the room if Fox is on. She's a smart girl. Anyways, you know, since I was home alone and seeking apparently some punishment, I'd been bad. I was a very bad boy.
Yeah.
So I had to turn on some Fox News, and the Trump lawyer lady, Alina Haba, she came on. She was gloating, you might say, Dom. She felt very glorious, you know, big victory, this reduction in the bond. And she reminded me of you. And I got to tell you, it wasn't becoming upon her or you, this glory.
Hey, I'd rather be good looking than smart, Curdy.
Yeah, you and her. Well, Dom, Alina Haba, attorney to former President Trump, mocked New York Attorney General Letitia James, much as you mocked me yesterday, Dom. After an appeals court significantly reduced the cost of the bond he must pay while he appeals his multi-million dollar civil fraud penalty. And Haba appeared on the Jesse Waters primetime on the Foxy News last night. And through some strange quirk of serendipity, I found myself watching the Jesse Waters primetime on the Foxy News yesterday.
Oh, you poor bastard.
Here's how she described it. We won. You know, no, we didn't win. You know, when we get all this reversed, which is it's gonna happen, she claims. It's all gonna get reversed.
Oh, okay. Okay, good.
You know, the actual bond reduction isn't much of a victory. It's a minor victory of sorts, right, Dom? But I was taking it hard, I'll admit. So Haba criticized James and Judge Arthur Engoron, who originally ordered Trump to pay $355 million before interest, ruling the former president conspired to lie about his net worth to receive favorable treatment from banks and insurers. The judge also ordered Trump to pay prejudgment interest with the figure accruing based on the date of each transaction in the case. The amount rose by more than $112,000 each day in additional interest, bringing it to $464 million by the time the appeals court ruled to lower his bond. What a glorious victory, as she described it. So what happened today, that was Letitia had to eat every single tweet she had posted since the day the twisted order from Judge Engoron came out with the ridiculous number, with the disgusting injustice on the American people, not just Donald Trump, Haba said. Haba said she would love to see what James posted online after the court's decision because she was having fun posting about the daily interest added to Trump's penalty. That did seem a little petty to me, but I read on. Trump and his lawyers attempted to get a bond covering the staggering sum, but were unable to do so before the Monday deadline. The five-judge appeals panel, without any real clarity, Dom, paused the enforcement of the judgment so long as Trump pays the significantly lower bond within 10 days. And you still think that's going to be a problem for him, but, you know, she seemed quite victorious.
Well, I don't know about a problem, but he hasn't done it yet.
Trump's attorney said she was so proud of the appeals court because the decision gave her a little bit of faith in the justice system. She continued, criticizing James and the others who were excited to see the former president approach the deadline with no ability to pay the sum. I count myself amongst that.
Yes, you're very excited. I was excited.
I hope she took a little piece of humble pie today because that was what was served to her. Just a little, but we'll be serving a lot more of that over the next couple of years. You'll be eating ramen noodles and nothing because your main client's going to stiff your ass and he will be broke as broke when he actually has to pay the underlying forfeiture.
Oh, and it's so, of course, this is, you know, a Trump attorney, and it's so misguided because, of course, the victims in this case are the people of New York, state of New York, the citizens of New York. Trump screwed them over.
Well, Dom, that's not the way they play it on Fox.
Well, of course they don't play it that way. They'd hate to say, oh, Trump is just continuing to screw the entire state of New York. Of course they're not going to say that because that sounds really bad. But if you personalize it to Tish James, well, you know, the racist Tish James, as they would say, oh, well, you know, you can't trust her and she's eating her humble pie. But as we stand here today, the money still has not yet been paid. I'm assuming the interest still accrues. Tick tock, and now, you know, we're another day closer, what, 20 days to the other trial in Manhattan. But in the meantime, Trump's coming to Green Bay, Wisconsin to stiff Green Bay and Wisconsin on the security that we have to provide for the criminal ex-president.
What you're saying, better he owes it to you, title town, than
never pay you.
844-967-2789. I can't believe you called me cheap, of all people. I might not be the least cheap guy, you know, but I'm not the most cheap guy.
You are not the most cheap guy I know, Curdy.
Who is?
I don't know. I got to think about that. I hang out with very generous people, man. I'm fortunate in my friends.
If you don't know, that makes you the most cheap guy you know. 844-967-2789. That's all because we're calling you the cheap one behind your back. Karina from Milwaukee. Welcome, Karina. What do you got for us?
Hi, Karina.
Hi, guys. I have an idea. You know, the Colorado state tried to take Trump off their ballot.
Yes.
I think what we should do, we should tell him that you're not welcome and you're not allowed to run anything what has to do with your campaign until you pay us.
Yeah, but that would be another qualification of the presidency that he'd be unable to meet. That's not in the Constitution. Trump's got to pay his debts. Is not part of the constitutional.
Well, sure, but Trump, but the other side of that, Karina, I mean, obviously the locals have to provide local security, local police forces, overtime, etc. I mean, certainly there's and given the history, there's no reason you couldn't ask for it up front. Trump is a private citizen. He's not a president. He doesn't have authority over the government or the executive branch. If you're going to allow him to come into your town, rent your facility, and require that your local police force show up and protect his ass, then you should get that money up for rent, COD, Karina.
Right, but he's already owe us money. We're not asking up front. He already owe us money. So he needs to pay his bill first.
Front rent? You'll be lucky to get the back rent.
No, I'm down, Karina. Absolutely. Not just, yes, yeah, to make it right. Not only do you have to, you know, get square on the old stuff, now you also have to prepay the current. Karina, I'm down, man. I hope Green Bay does that.
No, we should. We really, and actually the rest of the state, I'm sure he owes money to the rest of the state with his campaign. I think everybody should say, you know what, until you're going to start running around the state, pay us what you owe us for your previous run, and then we're going to consider whether you want us to run here or not. Otherwise, open up the ballot somewhere else, and maybe Wisconsin people will go to Illinois to vote for you.
Karina, I don't like your idea whatsoever, because I'm going to end up with Donald Trump in Madison, because that's the only town he's not been to, and stiff prior.
Well, it's the most democratic one, right? So we're safe.
That's why he's not going there. Thanks for the call, Karina. Appreciate it. As always, 844 967-2789. What are the locals saying up in Green Bay? Charles, you're next. Welcome. What do you got for us?
Hey, Charles.
Hey, you know what? Karina's got it. She is correct. Donald Trump, as last I heard, owed Green Bay probably about $200,000 in protection for the one time he came here before. And he also owes, I believe it's Wausau, when he was in Wausau the last time. He hasn't paid that bill yet, neither one of them. So does that mean that I, as a taxpayer of Green Bay, have to cover that money? You damn right it means that, because I don't like that idea. I think Karina's got the right idea. You pay up what you owe, and then you pay ahead, you know, and then you can come. Otherwise, park your ass someplace, and let's see what Letitia James put a parking ticket, you know, wheel lock on his airplane someplace, and let it sit there. I saw the greatest thing in the whole wide world. It was a picture of the Beast, and it was sitting at an airport, and it says, "Where's my airplane?" I think Letitia James should put the screws on the airplane first. Then let's see him do his campaign.
Well, Charles, he's probably one thought ahead of you in this regard. Donald Trump often does his campaign rallies in an airplane hangar, and then he comes out of the Trump Force One. They use that as the backdrop. And then he comes out, he walks out to the stage, he gives his little speech, and then he whisk him away. But he keeps that jet really close just so they can't seize it on his ass.
Keep it running. No. Keep it running. Keep it.
Appreciate your call, Charles. 844-967-2789. Mark from the SAC. Welcome back, Mark. What do you got?
Yeah, he better keep that airplane running. And has Trump violated the gag order yet?
It was just ordered today. We haven't even talked about it, Mark. Give him time. He'll violate it.
But I mean, the instance he does, I mean, that for any of us, you know, that doing what he has done and violating, you know, past gag orders and not supposed to be going after people, he's just violated. And when do he actually get served up like any of the rest of us is? Because Donald Trump is, at this point in time, he is Citizen Trump. That's all he is right now. He's got the security detail because he was, you know, past president. But right now he is just Citizen Trump and should be treated like any other citizen who, you know, violates the law when you go and insult. Going after, what, the judge's daughter, for the love of God? I mean, that...
Probably a dim donor, that girl.
For most of us, if some guy did that, we'd punch him in the nose if he was going after our daughter. I mean, that it is just that Donald Trump gets away with it again and again and again, and his supporters, you know, God love them, you know, that they're supposedly, you know, principled people. But, I mean, how do you abandon your principles to such an extent to continue to support the behavior of a man that behaves like Donald Trump?
Well, he's a celebrity, so they just let him do it. 844-967-2789. I don't mean to make light of your circumstance, Mark, but, you know, he is the scorpion we know. He did threaten to sting you. And, you know, he does often say, "I have bad intent." And why we, the American people, or at least the, you know, the MAGA Republicans of the world, they don't believe him. I don't know why. I don't know why they don't believe he has bad intentions. He says, "I have bad intentions. I will sting you." And he will. Come back. We are the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. And he will stiff you. I don't know who would ever give goods or services to that guy without cash up front. You know, I wouldn't serve him. I wouldn't wash his car without cash up front.
You know, I remember we got a restaurant here in Milwaukee I used to go to, and I was always so offended. My Fisher's, great place to go to the end of the bar night and get your food, you know, at 2 o'clock in the morning. It was always, you got to pay. You order, you pay right then and there. Too many dining in ditches, man. Trump, it's not GOP, it's not MEGA, it's COD.
Well, better you pay for his lunch than I, Dom. Or the good folks of Green Bay. Just the security. Mostly it's the security. Come back, more Devils Advocates, more of your phone calls. 844-967-2789. The good news, he ain't coming to Madison.
Do the Madison blues, baby. Rock away your blues.
Sorry, fellas, I'm having some technical issues here.
Occupy didn't start on Wall Street. It started on our street, the Devil's Advocates.
And thank you for listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show. Call us 844-967-2789, or you can download the super cool Civic Media app. Go to your favorite app store, download this fantastic app, get all the stations on the Civic Media network, hit the button, automatically text, automatically calls. Or if you're old school, pick up your rotary, 844-967-2789. You know what I'm talking about, Rich.
Dom, I've been trying to count the number of times that Donald Trump has been to Green Bay. It's been quite a few.
Yeah.
He's been there a lot. August of 2020, Trump to visit Green Bay Monday. I see the headline. Here's another one. June of 2020, President Trump visiting Green Bay and Marinette. Another one, the Post Crescent, April of 2019, Donald Trump to visit Green Bay. A lot of trips, at least four prior. This would be like fifth trip to Green Bay for Trump.
Oh, well, we've seen him up there at least a couple of times.
I feel like we have.
Too many times.
I know we've been.
I mean, too many times, man.
I still remember. Oh, here's the one I recall. And I bemoaned, and I've told this story a few times. Tim Kaine, the senator who became the VP candidate of Hillary Clinton. And they rolled out Tim Kaine at the Lakefront Brewery in Milwaukee.
Oh, that's right.
And there were a lot of important Democratic, you know, the stars of the Democratic Party, as you were. Tom Barrett was there, then the mayor of Milwaukee. And I remember Senator Tammy Baldwin being there. And we continued to join the press. And these political sorts would come over to the fence and we'd interview them. And then it was time to go on the Lakefront Brewery tour with Tim Kaine. And we got in the line, and at least I did.
You did, yeah.
And they said, oh, Crute, sorry, you're not welcome on this trip. You know, limited space and all. And I said, oh, I didn't realize there was separate credentialing because we were credentialed for the press, but apparently not the tour. So I turned around and I walked away. And I realized the only other person not on the press tour that day was you. It was you and I. We were the only excluded parties amongst the Wisconsin press. We were not allowed to enter the Lakefront Brewery at the same time as the vice presidential candidate, Tim Kaine. And we went immediately from that location, if you'll recall, Dom, to the Rush Center in Green Bay, Wisconsin. And the occasion was Donald Trump was coming to town. And this was late summer. This was probably August of 2020, I suspect. And no, I guess that would have been the 16 campaign. And so anyways, we went up to Green Bay, and I was in the wrong spot. Apparently, I was in the wrong spot. I came walking up, and at that time, I was acknowledged by a Trump staffer by sight. Mr. Crute, you're in the wrong spot. He knew me. I'm not that special. I'm not radio guy. Most people don't know me by sight. But anyways, he walked me over to the special VIP entrance, and I had to contrast at that time the treatment we received and the difference in the treatment from the Hillary campaign and the Trump campaign. Same day, different treatment, if you know what I'm saying. But here we are these years later, and Hillary's, you know, no longer a political fixture at the presidential level.
But the Biden campaign, man, we get to go in whenever Joe Biden comes to town, which has been a frequent occurrence of late. And I'm still wondering, Dom, whether or not we're even going to be let in to this Green Bay event, even if I could cajole you into attending with me. I'm not clear if you're going to be there or not. I'm not clear if we are going to be permitted into the Rush Center or not, because I pointed out last couple times I've been blocked from attending the Trump events. Newton, Iowa, that was a community college, a room you could rent for $1,500 for like a wedding reception. And then the next time I was not allowed in real time to attend a Trump event was at the wedding chapel at the Treasure Island Casino in Las Vegas. Why Trump wouldn't use the Trump Casino in Las Vegas, I'm still not clear. But that was also a small room. It was next to the wedding chapel. I'm not even sure if it was 400, 300 in the room. Like a wedding reception kind of room. This is not a presidential level political event sort of room. But I got to think the Rush Center in Green Bay would certainly accommodate all of the needs of the attending media and all the MAGA Republicans that want to go and join. I got to think there's plenty of room for everybody at the Rush Center. We know, we've been there. They've let us in before. So the only question I have as we end this hour, Dom, whether or not they'll let us in. And I think we should, you know, put our credential request in just in case,
just to see, just to test the system, you know, poke the bear, see if it'll let us in the door. Well, what if they say yes? Would we go? I don't want to go.
I think you should, but they'd probably say no. So I think we should seek the credentials and
okay.
Stiff on the credentials. If necessary.
All right, that's fine. If you want, I'll tell you what, put in for them. Put in for
inauguration,
and then we'll make the call, you know, that day.
We don't even know what time this said Trump event is. I mean, polls close in Wisconsin at 8 o'clock at night. Do you think Trump will go off? This will be a victory party. He'll want to claim glorious victory in the state of Wisconsin. I bet this is an evening rally, Dom. That'd be my prediction. You know, betting man. That and the fact that I would bet that he will stiff the community of Green Bay for his security that day.
Again. I mean, the trend line is certainly there. And hopefully Green Bay elected officials, you know, whoever's running the Rush Center or whoever's in charge of security, maybe should have that kind of that uncomfortable, payment conversation. You know, people like those uncomfortable parts. But yeah, we'd love to have you here, former Mr. President rapist, fraud. But how about, I got a great idea here. You give us a credit card, you know, or maybe a bag of cash. However you want to do it. Just pay us first, and then we'll see what we can do for you. One hand washes the other. They both wash the face. You know what I mean?
Wait. I've got a counter proposal.
Okay.
Future Truthy Social stock option.
Yeah.
I'm going to pay off Green Bay in future stock dividends. I mean, it's going to work out so well for the community. You're going to be so rich.
You're going to regret
not doing this the last time I stiffed you on the bills. Folks, we are the Devil's Advocates. Come back hour two under a gag order. Not this crew.
No.
Trump is.
You can't keep me in a corner.
We're barely under an FCC gag order, Dom. Barely keeps us legal. More in your phone calls, unless you're CJ. CJ, have you not figured out by now? You've continued on the banned list. You're like Trump coming to Green Bay. I'm not sure if we're going to be allowed in, but I feel pretty confident. Neither are you, at least on this show. More Devil's Advocates, everybody, except CJ. Welcome for hour three, 844-967-2789.
The Devil's Advocates Radio Show is broadcast under a time brokerage agreement between Devil Radio and Civic Media, Inc. Some portions of this program may be pre-recorded. Warning! You're about to listen to the greatest radio show ever, and due to contractual obligations and to shield our airwaves and corporate licensees from any semblance of liability, responsibility, and gullibility, we must tell you the views represented on this show are not necessarily those of this station or its management. This radio show contains differing points of view on current political topics, and due to the nature of its contents, it should be heard by everyone. Thank you for listening. Now live from the Civic Media Studios in Madison, Wisconsin, where the political party is just beginning, welcome to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. Friends proving it's never personal, only politics.
Please allow me to introduce myself.
And now, here's your hosts, Dom and Crute.
Welcome back to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show, the Tuesday edition, a happier, happy hour. And I think the nation may have dodged a bullet this morning, Dom. Supreme Court arguments taking place. I did watch some of the coverage in real time. They do now play out the arguments. And the Supreme Court seemed very skeptical of efforts to restrict access to the abortion pill. A majority of the justices, according to the subheadline at the Post, seemed to doubt the anti-abortion doctors had legal standing to challenge rules on mifepristone. Now, in light of the Dobbs ruling and the right, fact that abortion is legal, a lot of the abortive care, and I'm not trying to be an expert on this topic, certainly, and I would encourage the Supreme Court members not to pretend like they are experts either.
Right.
Ketanji Brown Jackson sort of lit up, I think it was Alito earlier today.
Yes.
A line of questioning basically laid it out. You ain't an expert. The FDA is. They have scientists here. This went through a gold standard approval process. And now you're going to change it all? You're going to question the science? You judge? How are you qualified to question the science? And at one point, I'm not sure which of the conservatives, but they went, maybe it was Alito, a bridge too far for him in this regard. There have been a number of injunctions he talked about. There had never been a district court injunction that had stopped anything nationally through Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And this last 2 years, some very compressed timeline, there have been 40 national rulings. He's like, why would this district court think they have the temerity to set the tone for the whole nation? That's not the way it's supposed to work. So that sort of skepticism met these arguments today. And the question of standing is going to kill their arguments. These supposed doctors that object to mifepristone have the right to conscientiously object in their own states, meaning they don't have to administer this abortion drug, antifezin, I think they call it. They don't have to give it. So why in the hell would they have standing to block it administered by other doctors?
Well, because if they don't give it, and I think one of the issues also was that nurse practitioners were also allowed to give this out. But besides that, listen, it's a bunk case to begin with from my reading of this. But their position, to my understanding, is that, well, I mean, even if we don't give it out, the patient takes it, and a small percentage, depending on what's, you know, statistics you look at, of those women who take this pill come in with cramping or go to the emergency room with different sort of issues. And then at that point, they would have to, you know, deal with it. And that's why it's a very problematic for them. Of course, it's all bunk. It's all just a matter of trying to, you know, tell women what to do with their bodies. And it's this, another chapter in the same book. So, I mean, I heard a little bit of the arguments today, did a little bit of the reading on this conversation. I agree with you. It sounds like it would be, you know, something that the Supreme Court would reject based on standing alone. But I mean, this is the same court that gave us Dobbs. So until that comes down, I'm not going to hold my breath.
Here's how the Post is reporting it. Washington Post, the Supreme Court on Tuesday seemed unlikely to limit access to mifepristone, a key medication that is used in more than 60% of U.S. abortions and has emerged as the next front in the battle over how and whether women can terminate their pregnancies. During nearly 2 hours of oral argument, a majority of the justices from across the ideological spectrum expressed skepticism that the anti-abortion doctors challenging the Food and Drug Administration's loosening of regulations for the long-approved medication have suffered the type of direct harm that would give them sufficient legal grounds to bring the lawsuit. That's the standing issue, right, Dom? And the Biden administration and drug manufacturers urge the justices to reverse a lower court ruling that would make it more difficult to access mifepristone in a case that centers on the role of government agencies in regulating medicine and returns the issue of abortion to the high court less than 2 years after the conservative majority overturned Roe v. Wade. Oh, yeah, that issue. Several justices, including Chief Justice Roberts and Justices Gorsuch, Ketanji, Brown Jackson, seemed interested in a narrow ruling that would not address the underlying regulatory or safety question in the case, but would retain existing levels of access that allow patients to use mifepristone later into pregnancy and obtain the medication directly by mail. Gorsuch, a member of President Donald Trump, a nominee of Trump, well, he's a member of the MAGA cult, question mark, joined Jackson, a nominee of Biden, in emphasizing that the Supreme Court often says its rulings should address the alleged harm at issue and go no further. Well, I'm glad that Gorsuch suddenly found restraint. Where was that last year with Dobbs, buddy? This case seems a prime example of turning what could be a small lawsuit into a nationwide legislative assembly on an FDA rule or any other federal government action, Gorsuch told the attorney representing the Organization of Anti-Abortion Doctors. Jackson said there is a significant mismatch between the claims made by the anti-abortion doctors and their lawsuit, and here's her quote, seeking an order preventing anyone from having access to these drugs at all. And since the Supreme Court eliminated the nationwide right to abortion in 2022, medications to terminate pregnancies have increased in importance because patients can get them by mail and take them at home, including in states that have severely limited or banned abortions. Yeah, think Wisconsin, Dom. They have been targeted in litigation for the same reasons.
If the justices allow last year's appeals court ruling to stand, mifepristone would still be available in the United States, but patients would have to obtain it in person, not by mail, and could only use it up to 7 weeks into pregnancy, even in states where abortion is legal.
That seems like a restraining sort of notion, tremendously.
I want to jump down here just a bit to get to my point with regards to the claimants, the doctors who have an issue with this. Again, from the Washington Post. The individuals behind the lawsuit do not use this product, do not prescribe this product, and have a conscious right not to treat anyone who has taken this product, said Danco attorney Jessica Ellsworth. Those individuals want to prevent anyone else from using it in line with FDA's considered scientific judgment. Erin Hawley, an attorney for the mifepristone challengers, said her clients who oppose abortion on moral and religious grounds suffer conscious harms when they have to intervene to treat a patient who experiences a complication after taking the medication. The doctors, quote, object not only to taking the life of an unborn child during an elective abortion, but also to completing that process, Hawley, a senior attorney with the Alliance Defending Freedom, a Christian conservative legal organization, said. But several justices, including Barrett and Lenny Kagan, pushed back on the statements from doctors included in the group's court filings, asking for examples of when Hawley's clients were enlisted to provide objectionable emergency treatment. You need a person to be able to come in and meet the court's regular standing requirements, Kagan told Hawley. So who's your person? After Hawley pointed to the objections of two specific doctors, Barrett followed up saying it was unclear whether they had personally been enlisted in an emergency to perform an abortion. A quote from Barrett. The difficulty here is that, at least to me, these affidavits do read more like a conscience objection is strictly to actually participating in the abortion to end the life of an embryo or fetus. Barrett said, adding that she did not interpret the doctor's statements to say they ever participated in that. The lawsuit was brought by the Alliance for Hippocratic Medicine, a group of anti-abortion doctors, and some individual physicians. They filed it in Texas, where the only sitting federal judge is Matthew Kaczmarek, a Trump nominee, well known for his longstanding opposition to abortion. The judge sided with the challengers last April and suspended the approval of mifepristone, which was first cleared for use in the United States in 2000. It was the first time a judge suspended long-term approval of a medication despite opposition from the FDA and the drug's manufacturer. The ruling embraced language used by anti-abortion activists referring to abortion providers as abortionists and to fetus and embryos as unborn humans.
Dom, back to the oral arguments earlier today. During the questioning of these, I'm going to read some of what Alito asked. And he was questioning the attorney representing Dinko, her name Jessica Ellsworth. During the questioning of the Solicitor General, the statement was made that no court has ever previously second-guessed the FDA's, and I'm sure I don't have the proper contemptuous tone in my voice. I can't really do an Alito. I haven't heard him enough. But the statement was made that no court has ever previously second-guessed the FDA's judgment about access to a drug, right? Alito said, do you think the FDA is infallible? That was the question he asked. We don't think the question is really teed up in any way to this case, Ellsworth replied. Moments later, Jackson responding to Alito's question by asking about the scientific knowledge of judges.
Yeah.
So you were asked if the agency is infallible, and I guess I'm wondering about the flip side, which is, do you think the courts have a specialized scientific knowledge with respect to pharmaceuticals? And as a company that has pharmaceuticals, do you have concerns about judges parsing medical and scientific studies? You know, like stuff they don't really know about. I think we have significant concerns about that. There are two amicus briefs before the pharmaceutical industry that expand on why exactly that's so concerning for pharmaceutical companies who do depend on the FDA's gold standard review process to approve their drugs and then be able to sell their products in line with that considered judgment. In other words, Alito, you ain't no scientist, man. Shut the beep up. I often feel like that speaking with you, Doug.
Thank you, Michael. Back,
or Douglas. 844-96-PARTY.
The Devil's Advocates, political commentary from the back of the class.
Yeah, thank you for listening to the Devil's Advocates radio show. Call us up on the lines, 844-967-2789.
Dom, breaking news. Your girl, Rona McDaniel, don't call her Romney, she's out. She got fired by NBC News. That didn't take long.
What?
After the network's anchors launched an unprecedented on-air rebellion. They had one last night as well on the MSNBC. Morning Joe said, he ain't having her. A lot of them said they ain't having it.
NBC News on Tuesday, that's today, Dom, ousted former Republican National Committee Chair Rhoda McDaniel just days after her hiring as a paid political analyst. Now, it's got to make you reconsider your hiring process. It really does. But apparently the hiring of McDaniel, Dom, sparked intense political backlash
from
the network's top television anchors over McDaniel's role in subverting the 2020 election. Oh, yeah, and the attacks on the press, crooked media, and all that stuff, Dom. There's no doubt that the last several days have been difficult for the news group, said NBC Universal News Group President Cesar Conde in a memo to the staff. After listening to the legitimate concerns of many of you, I have decided that Rhoda McDaniel will not be an NBC News contributor. Hired and fired, she appeared on one show, Dom. I want to personally apologize to our team members who felt like we let them down. You let them down.
Let them back down.
This was a collective recommendation by some members of our leadership team. I approved it and take full responsibility for it. Other people's fault, but, you know, buck stops here. Ahead of the network's decision, McDaniel spent the day Tuesday interviewing attorneys in preparation for a potential legal battle with NBC. A person familiar with the matter told CNN, my source, creative artist agency, the talent agency that brokered McDaniel's deal with NBC, also parted ways with her. So her agency fired her as well, Dom. We know it's hard to find a good agent. The reversal comes after journalists and anchors at both NBC and the cable news sibling MSNBC publicly denounced the decision to hire McDaniel as a paid analyst in a stunning and unprecedented on-air rebuke of network brass that has embarrassed the Peacock Network. And McDaniel, who recently stepped down under pressure, they say, from the former President Donald Trump's, what, the RNC, under pressure from former President Trump, was involved in attempts to overturn the results of the 2020 election. I think they mean Trump, not McDaniel in this case, Dom.
Well, McDaniel literally said at the J6 testimony that the RNC was there to help. The campaign, the Trump campaign took lead, and they were there to help. Help what? Help try to overturn the election. Journalist Aaron Rupar said this. I follow that guy on Twitter. You should follow us on Twitter at Devil Radio. Rona's NBC tenure lasted less than a Scaramucci. First, referring to Trump's ex-communications director who got fired 10 days after his appointment. Less than a Scaramucci, man.
It was like a tenth of a Scaramucci.
I mean, is it now McDaniel? It's a McDaniel now? Does she become a thing? This is really interesting. And obviously we talked about lots of consternation. Rachel Maddow went off. A bunch of the hosts went off, and I agree with them, every one of them. But I mean, the buck stops here. So what is the consequence of that decision? I mean, as far as I can tell, I mean, they might get sued by McDaniel. Okay, I mean,
that's
who knows?
Just a monetary issue.
What the terms of the agreement were? Presumably, there was some sort of employment contract. I don't know how it worked out, but maybe there was something there that, you know, they had to go against their contract, or they, you know, decided to take the risk and fire her and just let the cars fall where they may. But where's the consequence for the folks who were instrumental in hiring her? Because what I would tell you is that there's been a lot of conversation about MSNBC and NBC News in the last 48 hours. You know what I mean? I mean, don't you kind of wonder how that's playing out? So I've seen some folks wonder, hey, maybe we're all getting played. This is all done by them to, you know, shake it up a little bit. And we're the ones that are just, you know, here being entertained. I have a hard time believing if you're in any sort of hiring capability in a corporation like that at that level, that you didn't know there would be, I don't know, pushback on this. So while I'm not a conspiracy guy, it makes me wonder what the real motivation and point of all this was.
What would you imply it is? You think this was just a stunt and they hired and fired her for?
I think that's a stunt. I think it's certainly possible. Yes.
No. I discount your theory.
Yeah, because you got it all figured out, Creedy. Yeah, would you have hired her? You don't know squat about squat. You've never run a organization like that hiring with that kind of level. Would you have made that hire?
Let me point out to you.
Wait, hang on. Would you have made that hire?
May I?
I
have done a few programming decisions in my life.
Yeah.
If you are aware, for a network, and I can tell you, Dom, yeah, all those things, they're very difficult decisions made at the highest level by experts. But sometimes.
Would you have made that call, man? Come on. Of course not. No,
well,
you wouldn't. I don't believe you would have.
But have I ever made a controversial hire? Have I even considered some controversial hires just to stir the pot? Absolutely, man.
Well,
but
how can you absolutely,
about.
If you've done that yourself and the role that you have played in this world.
Well, not Ronan McDaniel.
How could you then, if you think that yourself, why would you're the only one who would make a controversial hire to stir the pot? You think that's the only idea belongs to Crute? You just said it, man. This is what I'm saying. I have no proof that I have no idea.
In certain lines you won't cross. We used to bring Ron Johnson around to stir the pot up on this show once in a while. Like 25, 26 times we invited the center, and he came and he showed up and he did interviews. And then the January 6th happened. And we drew a different line.
Sure, but that's different from a paid contributor, someone who's employed on the staff. You just said it yourself. Have you ever considered making a hire to stir the pot? Yes, you have.
Absolutely.
Well, then you absolutely discount my suggestion that maybe that someone else would have had that idea at NBC.
Oh, I absolutely think that was their bright idea, but I think it was a terrible idea. And I don't think the stunt was to hire and fire. That's very embarrassing. I mean, that's not how you do it. If you're going to hire her and you're doing it for a stunt, you're just... then let her go out there and get publicly flogged a little bit longer. I mean, let it be a train wreck. Let it be a car crash.
All right,
let
so maybe you have different,
watch her burn.
Different styles.
Let her be but the if, Joan of Arc of your network.
If you
let
fire, if you bring him on to fire him in a month or a week or a day, it's still the same thought process, man.
Well,
yes,
we all get fired someday, Dom.
Yeah.
We all get fired someday. The tenure. You know, longer for some than others. We've been making the greatest radio show ever for 13 years. 13! Going on 13. That's a little longer than the Scaramucci, let's say.
Or McDaniel.
But, you know, we've mostly clung to this position by trying to be our own bosses and not having executives or feedback that, you know, we depend upon for our livelihoods. You know, because there are days when I'm pretty sure the audience would fire your ass in a heartbeat. 844-967-2789. In fact, today could be that day. If you want to fire Dom, call right now.
844-967-2789. Bring it.
the devil's advocates, the fix for political junkies everywhere.
Welcome back to the Devil's Advocates Radio Show. Sometimes the host has to get fired, and today might be Dom's day. We're taking a poll. 844-967-2789. You have his career in your hands.
Yeah. you poor people. That's not much of a career.
It truly isn't. But it's so high paying.
Yeah.
Mark from Sussex, welcome. What do you got for us? Should Dom be fired? Like your girl, Rona McDaniel Romney.
Thanks for taking my call there, gentlemen. But no, Dom should not be fired. Although you would probably save a lot of money on your alcohol expenses, the way it sounds. So
it's really more than a salary, Mark.
So I guess what a great couple of days here for Trump. He just keeps getting richer and richer with this whole truth. What's the interest on $3 or $4 billion, do you think? I mean, on an annual basis, is that
do you think that stock price will hold, Mark? Because, you know, when you look at the underlying, they're basically valuing the corporation at 2,000 times earnings. Like Google is trading at like 9 times earnings. Do you think Truth Social is worth that valuation, sir? Do you think it'll hold up on the long end?
I do not. But even if it's only a billion, it's still a B as in billion.
But what if it's a million?
Right.
Because this is very speculative, Mark, and I don't disagree. Perceptually, Donald Trump's killing it this week. His meme stock, as they're calling it, because there is no underlying reason to buy the stock. You're doing so because you're a fan of Trump, right? That seems to be the rationale. And the stock is up like 30%. And if I were a betting man, Mark, and a day trader, I'd be shorting that stock. Oh, I'd be betting against that valuation.
Absolutely. And it's just not Trump-backed people that are buying it. That's all your hedge funds. That's all
No, come on, man.
You never struck me as naive.
I have no doubt. If you get into something, whatever the speculation is, whatever the underlying thing is, there's folks that are out there that will gamble, Mark. I totally get that. But I would imagine most folks are going to take the short. They're going to do the puts. They're going to think it's going to go down because the underlying numbers, which really what it comes down to, once you get beyond the grift and once you get beyond the hype, all you have left with are earnings, and there ain't none, Mark. And if you look at the track record of Donald Trump, I mean, how are the steaks? How are the vodkas? How's the airline? Yada, yada, yada. I mean, if anything, I'll give you this. Trump has made money while he's scammed other people, and other people lost lots of money on his endeavors. I guess if you consider that good business, well, it's making money. I don't know if I would call it good business, Mark.
Mark, I will bet you a steak dinner at your choice of restaurants. And I'm not a cheap bastard like Dom. But I will buy you a steak dinner if 6 months from the day, you know, the cash out day, if that stock valuation of Donald Trump's is worth anywhere close to $3 billion, I'm saying it's way less than $1 billion, way, way, way less. Mark, I think this stock will crash within a matter of weeks.
Crudy, it's still $1 billion.
It's a piece of paper until you can sell it for something, sir. I mean, that's like me taking it.
No, I get that. I understand how it works.
My lake house is worth $1 billion, but I can't sell it for that. I can't sell it at all. I mean, the guy's hogtied by his own corporate bylaws.
Well, and he might be able to.
Should be.
Get out of that,
Mark. He's the namesake of the Truthy Social. If he turns around and wants to mass sell his stock, that corporation's just going belly up, and all the stockholders are going to sue him. Because that wouldn't be a fiduciary action on behalf of the corporation. He's got to do not just what's in the best interest of Donald Trump, but what's in the best interest of all the stockholders. And he might own 60, but the 40% will sue his ass if he crashes this stock by cashing out.
And that's why I said today.
Oh, he's having a hell of a day today.
With $3 or $4 billion versus, and then, by the way, it went up 56% today. So. which is unbelievable.
Are you buying the stock, Mark? Honestly. Come on, be honest.
Zero chance.
Yeah, exactly, man. So, you know, this is a hypothetical conversation, but, you know, let's all join Robinhood and dive right into that Trump SPAC, right?
Well, again, I appreciate the call there, gentlemen.
All right, thank you. Appreciate you listening, Mark.
He doesn't want to fire you. 847-267-2789. Let's keep her moving.
Hey, let me throw this out there, man. Trump Media Technology Corporation, according to Yahoo Finance, is up almost 7% in after-hours trading, just under $62 a share.
That's just the bump Mark gave him on the Devil's Advocate show. Buy. I don't normally give stock advice, but if you're a MAGA, please invest what you can in the DJT.
That's a bad idea.
Blue Endicott loves DJT. I thought it was Endicott Steel, actually, but anyways, I confused that movie. It's been a long time since I watched Wall Street. 844-967-2789. Trucker Dean headed to Augusta. Keep her between the lines, Trucker Dean.
Hey, Dean.
Hey, guys. Yeah, I'm going to try here, but I'll do all right. Dom, you're safe with me. You've got no problems. This long hair has got to stick together, you know?
All right. Appreciate that, man.
But if you want to get, Crute, you want to get up and make a little noise like MSNBC, I think you should hire CJ as your call screener, at least for a couple of days.
Let CJ screen him?
Yeah, why not?
Well, that would really offend everybody else, though, Trucker Dean. You wouldn't have made it to the airwaves today.
No.
You'd still be arguing with the man.
Now, Dean, if we're going to do the thing, then he'd have to actually be on the air with us. He'd be like, hey, Trucker Dean, welcome to the show. You got Dom, you got the Crute, da-da-da. What do you got to say about the CJ? And then he'd be able to, you know, give you his thoughts. And much like...
Big Gazi!
Much like McDaniel, you know,
it may not be exactly
what you thought it would be.
I would just like to see him in the same room together like that.
Well, I've been in the same room with the guy. He'll show up at the bar events.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, you serve beer. You can't keep that guy away.
But, yeah, him too. Wait.
Your office, then.
I'll never leave.
Trucker Dean, appreciate you. 844-967-2789. Uncle Mike from Madison. I didn't even know I had an Uncle Mike. Welcome. What do you got for us?
What's up, Uncle Mike?
Well, a couple things, gentlemen. First of all, I think it was, 4, 6, 8 weeks ago, Dom was running the show by himself, and I know I speak for millions and millions of listeners. He did a pretty damn good job.
Oh, thanks,
I think it should
Mike.
Be like that every day, then. Don't you, Dom? I'll throw myself on the petard. I will quit for the sake of the show. Mike, you're stuck with him.
Wait. I don't want to say that. Let's not go crazy.
Yeah, this looks good. Come on, man. We're not saying that.
Well, I'm sure that sometime on Twitter today that Elon Musk is going to type in Trump stonk and – as in game stonk, you know?
Yeah. Trump, I remember Trump, when he gave the big
you're
boost.
Supposed to be laughing at that. I'm very
I'm laughing on the inside, Uncle Mike.
You sucked Dom's sense of humor right out of him.
See?
The guy can't even laugh anymore.
I know, man. It's just so much pressure, Mike. It's tough to deal with this in work environment when, you know, I'm on the fence all the time. Am I going to have a job?
Mike,
am I not?
And I've lifted the funny here, man. You got to do funnier.
Yeah, well, I'm going to put this in my review. I can tell you that. Right now.
It's going to go down in your permanent record.
Love you guys. Bye.
Thanks, Uncle Mike. Appreciate it, man.
Thank God we're not on Yelp.
967-2789-844-96 Party. Joe from Madison. You're next. Welcome, Joe. What do you got today?
Hey, Joe.
Well, I am struck by the line that you had a bit ago, Dom, where you said, I have been fortunate in my friends. And, boy, that just really hit me today. I think you're a lucky man. you're a lucky man to be able to make that statement, and I'm assuming that that Crute is still one of those friends.
Well, technically, Joe, what he said is, I'm lucky to have generous friends, which I take by process of elimination to mean, if there's a cheap bastard amongst us, just might be him.
I thought he just said, I am fortunate in my friends. Not
that's
not
what I said, yes.
Generous or not.
Well, yeah, well, that so that indeed say, is true. He's very, very lucky in friendships.
Well, I'm going to be a little bit nostalgic, a little bit melancholy here when I say that, because you guys have been through hard times, you've been through good times, you've been since college days. Yesterday, or a couple days ago, you spoke about that and how it's still always the spirited discussions and the fun, and you provide an excellent example of friends who can dish it up and fence with each other and still keep the friendship going. And that's an extraordinary gift. And I think it's so lucky for you guys and provides such a wonderful example, because with all this attention on Trump, there's a guy who has no friends. Everybody for him is just transactional. Either you're helping me out, making money, or you're gone in revenge. I mean, it's a guy who can't even manage to have a dog. He can't even manage a pet. And I guess swinging back to something that's happening in today, that awful situation in Baltimore where the bridge collapsed, and it's obviously the loss of life and is terrible, but it's also going to be a huge blow to the economy and to people with jobs in that area. There are tons of people.
Very
who,
traveled.
It's one of the busiest.
Yeah, go ahead. Busiest northeastern corridor bridges.
Yeah, one of the biggest ports, active ports in the country. And so the blow that has been dealt today, in terms of that tragedy, just, sharpens it even a little bit more to say, if a person is able to say, I have been fortunate in my friends, man, you are, both of you are very, very lucky. So I just wanted to throw that into the mix. So don't fire him. Don't fire him. Okay.
He's more fortunate than I in our friendships.
Thank you for the very kind words, Joe. Certainly appreciate your perspective always. 844-967-2789.
Why did no one stand up and say, don't fire Crute?
Well, that wasn't the question, man. You gotta pose it differently. I woke up this morning. Of course, the first thing you see is this bridge and the CC cameras and the video of it, and looks almost slow motion. I mean, what a disaster. And I watched it a few times. I kind of zoomed in and you realize there's trucks on that bridge. There's people on that bridge. And apparently they were filling some potholes, and they had, as I was watching it a few times, it looks like they had, municipal cars, with their trucks or whatever with the lights on them. Cause they're doing their work on the bridge. And apparently still six of those highway workers are still missing. And just a horrible tragedy all the way around. And I think what will be interesting is to see how we as a country certainly come around to fix this issue. Infrastructure, obviously a big issue here. We got
Joe
this
Biden's
bill.
Already, sorry said, to interrupt, Don, but Joe yeah. Biden already came out and said the federal government will pay for the replacement. This bridge will be rebuilt quickly with alacrity. And I saw Amy Klobuchar and obviously Minneapolis, Minnesota, also affected by the, the tragedy of a fallen bridge, different circumstance.
Yeah.
That bridge was fully replaced, according to Klobuchar, Senator Klobuchar, 13 months.
Yeah, real quick. And that's what it's going to take. It's going to take that kind of effort, federal, certainly the workers and the communities to come together and fund it and do the work and make it happen. And then there's the other side. Alex Jones and Mike Flynn talking about, was it terrorism? And there's a cyber attack coming next. And World War III has already started. And all these kinds of, just nonsensical, unproven, no evidence thereof of that. But that's where they go to. That's their place. And I thought that was just, given the circumstances of this and no proof or evidence of any of that. Apparently, they lost power. They lost the ability to steer that ship. And they did a mayday prior to hitting that, and it seems like an unfortunate accident, but don't tell that to Alex Jones or Mike Flynn.
What about Aaron Jones? What do you think he thinks?
Aaron Rodgers?
Oh, yeah, Aaron Rodgers. My bad. Damn it. Now I got to get fired.
Fire them again.
Devil's Advocates. 844-967-2789.
You're listening to the radio show your mother warned you about, The Devil's Advocates.
And thank you for listening to The Devil's Advocates radio show. Some say the greatest radio show ever, but it's our last segment of the day. So if you got something to say, you want to be a part, join us right now at 844-967-2789. Stick around. Our pals over at Busted Pencils are coming up next.
I'm just enjoying a few of the text lines, Dom. Here's one. A question. Crute may not be cheap, but are you easy? I'm a little insulted you don't know the answer to that.
The answer is yes. Might not be cheap. I might be cheap, but I ain't easy. I might not be cheap, but I ain't easy. How's it go?
You're both cheap and easy.
I make it up on volume.
844-967-2789. Dom. When you're really trying to grift, and someone I saw tweeted at us at the Devil Radio, at Devil Radio, and they said, you know, this DJT stock, this is like the laundromat of the cesspool, right? Everybody's throwing their dirty money in the DJT stock, you know, to show good graces with the old man because, you know, they're hopefully might be the president again. And I think that might be an astute thought because if the stock is up on DJT, it's not because of the underlying fundamentals, certainly, Dom. You know, this stock is being valuated at 2,000 times earnings. But, you know, as Mark points out, a good headline week, apparently, to his perception, for Donald J. Trump. You know, it's only Tuesday. It could change. But here's one. Here's one, Mark. I wonder, what do you think of Trump hawking $60 MAGA Bibles? This is his newest grift. MAGA Bibles. Yeah. You see this, Dom? Let me show
you. Of course, man. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me?
MAGA Bibles. I mean,
remember when he was in front of the church when he walked through and they cleared the park of all the peaceful protesters with tear gas and he walked over with the general and held the Bible upside down in front of the church? Remember that? I mean, are the crosses going to be upside down in the MAGA Bible? I'm just not clear.
Social media users were shocked and appalled that Donald Trump was hawking patriotic-themed Bibles named after country singer Lee Greenwood. I guess he's proud to be an American, Dom. The former president started off Holy Week by sharing a supporter's post comparing his criminal civil travails, you know, to Christ's crucifixion.
Totally the same.
Too
I mean,
bad. And the timing couldn't be any more conspicuous. It's the Holy Week. And Trump's being persecuted. They're taking Trump Tower. And anyways, that was the analogy, I guess. But he followed up Tuesday by promoting the God Bless the USA Bible, Dom, named after Greenwood's enduring 1984 chestnut. Happy Holy Week. Let's make America pray again.
Oh, my goodness.
Make America pray again.
I don't
want to
join a cult.
He posted on the Truthy socials. This is Trump's post. As we lead into Good Friday and Easter, I encourage you to get a copy of the God Bless the USA and Nowhere Else Bible.
I'd like to thank God for this victory.
I believe that was the candidate in the campaign, right? God bless the USA and no place else. The ex-president, that'd be Trump, posted a link to a website selling the Bibles. Oh, what a value, Dom. $59.99.
Can I make
for both Old and New Testaments?
Can I make multiple payments on that? Yeah, it's a fair question.
Well, Dom, there is a wait for delivery, 4 to 6 weeks. Yeah, you're going to have to put off your praying for a bit.
Come on, I could die and lay and go to hell and rise again by that time.
And the frequently asked questions make clear, Dom, these are the only Bibles endorsed by either Trump or Lee Greenwood. You know, don't get a second-rate King James Bible. Yeah. Can't trust that Bible. Easy to read, large.
What? Wait. Easy to read? I mean, do they change the verbiage? I mean, is it Cliff Notes version? Because I tried once, and there's like a lot of like family names laid out in that Bible.
Well, Dom, let me give the description from the website. You know, let me do the marketing on behalf of the
Bible.
USA Greenwood Bible. Easy to read.
Endorsed by Jesus.
Large print. Slim design.
they took out all the sinning.
They actually took out the New Testament part. The Jesus part. Less down on the Jesus part, these magas. But anyways, the Bible invites you to explore God's word anywhere, anytime. Couldn't I do that on my cell phone?
I mean, but anyway, you could, but it wouldn't be a Trump endorsed Bible.
Dom, this Bible has been designed so that it delivers an easy reading experience in the trusted, thank God, in the trusted King James Version translation.
Is that a good version? I'm not clear. Why would the King James Version be trusted as the non?
Why.
Okay, all right, fair enough.
Mostly because it's in English. The King James Version translation. This large print Bible will be perfect to take to church, a Bible study, work, travel, or when you're visiting a porn star you might have to pay off later.
you never know.
The Greenwood theme Bibles include a handwritten chorus to God Bless the USA and copies, as all Bibles do, Dom, of the U.S. Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Declaration of Independence, and the Pledge of Allegiance. Here is what commentator Keith Olbermann noted. The son of a bitch is now selling Trump Bibles.
Is that a copyright violation? The King James come knocking on that door.
Huffington Post congressional reporter Jonathan Nicholson said, lest you think selling a Bible inspired by Lee Greenwood's God Bless the USA song would be a last-ditch cash grab by a guy suddenly needing cash. It appears that there's at least one more ditch. Geez Louise, he's grifting off the Bible now.
Yeah, baby.
Your boy, Aaron Ruper, added, and Trump and Lee Greenwood dropped the product with insane levels of sacrilege in the middle of Holy Week. Laugh out loud. That, according to the Bulwark's columnist, Joe Perticone. Naturally, it's from the same folks who brought you Trump sneakers. Now, I would wonder, it's probably more like a flag, you know, because it's got the Constitution and all. You know, we've got Congressman Mark Pocan coming Thursday.
Oh, okay.
Joining us right nice. From the top, four from the 4 o'clock top, the happy hour top. And a week from now, Trump comes to Wisconsin, Green Bay. I hope he brings the Lee Greenwood Bibles.
All your prayers have been answered, Mega. Your orange Messiah is coming. Bring your $60 for the Trump Bible.
I love you all. I love the USA. God bless America and nowhere else. See you tomorrow on the radio.
Thank you, Rich. What the hell, man? All right, fellas. See you on the radio tomorrow.